do in a day. But out of those smokers, we are saying about 6 million people are dying from one or other disease caused by tobacco use.
Every year.
The problem is, after interventions, smoking is falling in developed countries.
Yes.
But in the developed countries like ours,
the
smoking
countries.
Is coming up. Yes.
The rich men are abandoning it.
They're abandoning
it. The poor ones are taking it.
The poor ones are taking it. In other words, we are saying there is more promotion of tobacco use in developing countries, partly because the people are still ignorant, if I may put it in inverted commas, ignorant of the hazards of tobacco use. And we don't have policies yet in place to curb the tobacco epidemic. Whereas in our colleagues, developed countries, they have already policies in place. And for some reason, our friends in developed countries, they stick to their policies, they respect their policies, whereas in developing countries, we still have that kind of...
We shift goalposts.
Well, it goes. It can still go. We wait tomorrow. It's not too bad.
Right.
Until you really get... It gets into your family. If you have somebody dying of cancer because of smoking,
that's when you get to wake up.
That's when you start saying, well, perhaps I shouldn't continue smoking. And
let's talk about policies. Is outdoor smoking one, a restricted smoking, either not smoking on the plane or not smoking in an open place, public place? Talk to us about policies that have worked in the developed world.
In the developed world, some of the policies which created a lot of impact is what we call smoke-free public places.
Yes.
In other words, if you're smoking, you may not use it anywhere the way you want. In an enclosed space, for example, under a roof or an enclosure with one or more walls, this is considered as an enclosed place.
Yes.
And if it is frequented by the public, that is, many people have access into this area,
yes,
you may not light up. If you are outside, in a theater, open theater, even if you're standing at bus station where people can congregate,
many people conglomerating,
you are not free to light up. You have to do it away from the other people.
Right.
So this policy, when it was enforced and complied to in the developed world, it changed a lot of, it made a lot of impact. In fact, one of the biggest impact was the stopping of smoking in restaurants and bars, where people thought that this is a recreation place, we go there to be happy and everything goes, but that is the first place where the biggest impact came into.
All right.
You cannot smoke in those places.
Talk to us very briefly before we move forward to Mr. Baguma. Talk to us very briefly about the dangers of passive smoking. You are smoking your cigarette. Why should I be affected and how?
If I smoke a cigarette, I exhale smoke.
Yes.
That smoke which I exhale is not very different from the smoke
which the man is inhaling.
But not only the smoke I inhale. Normally you don't smoke a cigarette all of a sudden, hold the smoke in the lungs and then exhale it.
Yes.
You smoke leisurely
and it burns.
You put a cigarette in an ashtray, and that smoke which comes from the ashtray is worse than the smoke which you exhale. The reason is, the smoke you exhale, you force the tobacco to burn. So you have pressure burning of the cigarette, of the tobacco.
Yes.
But when it is lying on the ashtray, it burns completely. And the products of combustion are totally discharged. That means, that what we call the mainstream smoke, which is more poisonous, more toxic than the smoke that you exhale. Imagine on a pub, there are 100 people, of which 30 are smokers. Each one is puffing smoke, and each one is lighting a cigarette or a cigar or a pipe or whatever.
Right.
Put together, the mainstream and sidestream smoke is a concentration of a poisonous element. So, you're just a smoker, and perhaps you're smoking more than the person is smoking actively.
Mr. Richard Baguma, talk to us about the Ugandan situation. You said it was difficult to get statistics. Can you give us a little bit about the statistics, what they give us, and what the future looks like?
The some of the Ugandan statistics is derived, if I may say,
If you look at, for instance, this has been Cancer Awareness Month, and the media has been covering a lot about cancer. If you look at the increase in the cancers, just the numbers getting cancers, the different, but also the types of cancers in the country. And if you, for instance, visit the Cancer Institute at Mulago, you get shocked by the numbers. Now, a lot of us do not connect these diseases to the tobacco,
yes,
that we consume,
right?
And what is even worse is that in many of the rural areas, these cancers, when they start, they are taken as witchcraft, they are taken, because they cannot be explained. And by the time we get to get any assistance, medical assistance, it is too late. So there has been an exponential increase in the cancers, and also the growth of statistics of cigarette consumption is derived from, for example, the tax that is paid, or the increased acreage of tobacco growth in the regions, because certainly there are people consuming it. And it is among the young. It is among the youth and the women too. It is estimated now that even there is a doubling of consumption of cigarettes among the females.
Why are you smoking more?
I just don't understand why this is like this.
Well, maybe they're getting more hip, since state people think it's about
hip
fashion. Okay. As well. Dr. Prossy Mugyenyi, thank you for making it into the studio, finally.
Thank you.
Can you talk to us about how you can kick this habit?
Yeah, before I do that, I just want to make a quick comment on what I found there, Richard, talking about the issue of women picking up the smoking habit.
Yes.
When you look at the statistics among the old, the old generation, you find a significantly higher rate of smoking among the men compared to women.
Older men smoke more
than the
old women. Yes.
But when you see the young ladies,
it's the women who beat
the women are catching up. Yes, and I think it might be they think it is an gender issue, they want to look like men, and yet they are picking up a very dangerous habit.
Their genes are lighter.
I think so, it's worrying, because you see, when we talk of smoking, we are talking about affecting yourself and affecting people who are around you, secondhand
right.
smoking.
Yes.
Now, for women, secondhand smoking is more fatal.
What do you mean?
Because it affects the children. A woman
right.
is always with the children.
Yes.
The children are always with you. So it affects the children whom you are nurturing, whom you are breastfeeding, whom you are looking after, whom you are bathing. But not only that, it affects the child inside. You are wrong.
The unborn child.
The unborn child. So if a woman is smoking, she's like to produce a very tiny child, what we call low birth weight.
Right.
A child who is really not the normal size. And of course, with robust weight, you have other problems of growth.
Right.
So, for women, we are worried when women take up smoking, it is more fatal than when it is in men. I'm not saying in men it is good, but it is worse in women.
It's got a higher multiplier effect.
Yes.
Talk to us about kicking the habit. If you're educated and you're lighting up, how do you begin to say no to it?
I think the first stage is to accept that there is you are having a dangerous habit. You see, acceptance of a problem is the first stage of solving the problem. To first accept that I'm in this thing and it's not a good thing. That is the first step. The second step is to be open to ideas. When you hear a talk show smoking and you are smoking, take time to listen.
Right.
Tune in and say, could they be saying something that you didn't know? And read some magazines. When we are going to be active in writing in the newspapers, we are going to be active in producing some pamphlets. So when you see something, don't close your eyes. And your ears and say, no, I don't want to hear, but try to listen, because you never know, you may learn something new. And of course, the third stage is what actually we are going to work with the government, especially the Ministry of Health and other ministries, to see whether we can put cessation programs, some programs to help people to quit the habit, because there are programs which have been designed, mainly the behavior change programs, to help people to change the habit.
And yes. If I may step in, I used to smoke.
Yes.
And I quit.
Right. How did you do it?
For me, I don't know if this is what everybody goes through.
Yes.
But it was in the mind.
Right.
It started from the mind. There was one person whom I looked up to a lot. Mm-hmm. One model, if I may say.
Right.
And his campaign was, I must stop drinking.
Yes.
And I must stop smoking.
And you followed them.
And it was not straightforward. No, it wasn't straightforward. I didn't just pick it up and follow it.
Right.
It took a process. It took consistency. It took him to really... And he approached it in a manner that was not condemning.
Right.
He didn't condemn me. And I was very young. I was in school. He was a little bit boy. When I think I was in senior one or something. Doctor meeting.
Yeah, right.
I was very young, but I started smoking at that level. Right. Senior one.
Yes.
Peer influence.
Right.
Big boys sending it right for them upstairs.
And then you take two.
And it takes so many years to break the thing. But usually it starts in the head.
Right.
And then it gets into action. But it cannot be said to be easy. So there is need for this kind of assistance, this kind of support, and consistent information. And reflection.
Talk to us while we're at it. Promotion advertising. The government of Uganda banned promotion of advertising or any advertising of tobacco product. Has that helped?
Well, we need to study that.
In the electronic media.
We need to study that. Because what stopped, in my view, is direct advertising.
Yes.
I think indirect advertising still goes on.
What's that, through movies and so on?
No, just through sports, for instance. They see a lot of tobacco messages through sponsoring my colleagues in the Sports Press Association,
right.
Through sponsoring, what do you call this game where you hit the small ball on the table, and you are there and whatever. They are there.
Right.
And so they don't say cigarettes directly. But who is there to support this?
Right.
They are the
proud sponsors.
Companies, proud sponsors. And they will take space in the newspapers, they will take space on radio, and they take it in at a cheaper cost. Because it is indirect.
Right. Mm-hmm. And very briefly, how are the campaign managed? Very briefly, before we hear from the listeners.
This is the beginning. We have started, and we would like to first sensitize ourselves, for instance, the media. And this center, it needs to be understood that is not an implementing center. It is giving support to governments and countries to take up their tobacco control initiatives.
Let's hear from the listeners. This is Spectrum on Radio. And tonight, what are the dangers of tobacco use and measures that can be taken to deal with the situation? You can call in now. Our numbers 0414-348-111, 0312-260-390, 0312-261-390. When you call in, please tell us your name and where you are calling from. Spectrum, hello?
Yeah, sir, my name is Daniel.
Yes,
and I'm calling from Shireka. Thanks so much, Edmond, for hosting those guests. And I think the issue they're discussing are very pertinent. I think one of the things that we have to really work on as a nation is to stick by what we agree we want to do. For example, if we say we want to have stop public smoking, let's try to do that. There are so many problems with public smoking in this country. And even when sometimes there's the policemen themselves, sometimes it's other law enforcement officers. But that notwithstanding, I want to show the support that we have for the stop smoking campaign, because if we can help people stop smoking, then we have something that is very practical. And I must say that our church where I worship in Namgong, we're planning a 5-day stop smoking campaign where we'll invite people to come and learn over 5 days how they can stop smoking. And I think it would be a good thing for us to find out.
Which church is that?
Namgong SDA Church.
Which church?
Namgong SDA Church.
Namgong SDA Church.
Yes,
it is. When is the campaign running?
We'll start in December, hopefully.
In December?
We hope so, yes.
All right.
We're making preparations.
Interesting there, Daniel. The church helping to fight tobacco use or even abuse. Spectrum. Okay. Hello. Please tell us your name and where you are calling from. Okay, let's continue. Dr. Machangu, I'll hear you from here about that campaign on that side, how other, you know, civil society groups can help. Talk to us about the World Health Organization framework on tobacco control. One of the tools that have been fronted is the so-called WHO framework. What is it?
Well, this is a treaty. It's an agreement.
All right. Let's take...
Hello.
Yes, sir, your name?
I am okay. My name is Methodius.
Methodius.
I was just thinking that can the gentleman in the studio tell us the at least the least importance is okay the least the uses of tobacco, how it can be used either to make other goods and services. Because I've heard only the negative side of tobacco. But then tobacco has any positive side.
Right.
If it's that bad,
right.
Why don't the government just ban it like you treat it like the way you treat opium and all the other drugs? And instead it's left to be sold in shops and everywhere else. So that is a concern, because tobacco also provides jobs in terms of employment for those who work in tobacco companies. And for those who say that there are uses, maybe, or there are other ways you can talk about it. Yes, appreciate the positive, and then you can go negative. Otherwise, for a smoker, the moment they hear someone blasting smoking directly, then they switch off.
All right. Okay. Let's get our final call. Spectrum. Hello. 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 Your name?
Yeah, Justin Hero is my name. And my question is actually, thank you for this good talk, really. My concern is that sometimes you're walking on the street, you're following somebody smoking, just making a passive smoker in that sense. I'm wondering, at one time I heard the government was planning to ban smoking in public. Is it, what happened to that process? Was it ignored? Is it to meet my concern, really? Why can't they do something about our country so that we still enjoy ourselves in Uganda as for God and my country? Thank you.
All right, Dr. Machangu.
Yeah, maybe I should go back to
the framework. We'll hear about
the framework. The framework convention is an agreement, is a treaty among the world nations, which was initiated by the WHO. Actually, the whole process of negotiation started back in 1999, and it went through to 2003, when finally the world nations, after thorough negotiations, agreed to have this agreement, which was to address the demand and supply of tobacco and how to curb these two areas which make tobacco available and of course used by the people. The convention has got about 23 articles or provisions, implementable provisions, but then they've got other areas. And among those, if I may mention a few, we refer to the provision number 8, which addresses the prohibition of smoking in public places, with provision number 11, which demands that all tobacco containing materials are labeled with serious, very pregnant warnings showing the dangers of smoke, preferably in pictorial form where you can show a cancerous lip or a cancerous lung to show
on a cigarette pack.
And in fact, many countries in the world have already embarked on that.
And they can sell those cigarettes too?
The cigarettes are sold. The reason is the addiction of tobacco is so very strong that a smoker is prepared to buy a packet of cigarette with that ugly picture on it
and die slowly.
Kind of look the other way, opens the packet, removes all the cigarettes and puts them in a metal
cleaner job, a cleaner place,
so that he doesn't go on seeing that ugly picture. Number 13 provision was on the advertising, that tobacco should not be advertised in any manner,
right,
directly or indirectly, or using objects like plastic bags, or using umbrellas, using, you know, all this. We go to bars these days, what you find on the table is sportsman, SM, ashtrays, etc. And then we have a provision on education, that the nations have agreed to educate their people on the hazards of tobacco, to assist those who smoke, cease from smoking, and to help those who have not started to stop starting to use tobacco.
All right, Mr. Baguma, you talked to us about the possibility of CSOs coming into this campaign. But before I do that, Dr. Mugyenyi, is there a good side to tobacco apart from the economy?
Yeah, of course, there is. a good side of it. Of course, as the caller said, instead yes, government of Uganda picks 68 million dollars from taxes on tobacco
every year. $68 million
paid, of course, by the smokers and a part of it by the tobacco industries. But it provides employment to some people. But for us, we talk of a balance sheet. What we get and what we lose. When you put it on a balance sheet, what you get as a country from tobacco, and you compare with what you lose,
it's a negative balance.
There is a negative balance. Not talking about the people who die. You see, when you lose 10,000 people, even if you are getting $1 billion, the 10,000 people shouldn't die in the first place.
Right.
So there is nobody who can say, okay, let my father die so that the government can get $70 million.
Right.
Nobody can accept that. So the negative effects are much more
outside the taxes.
Yeah, if you go to the Cancer Institute and see how many people have lung cancer as a result of tobacco smoking. When you go to the other wards and see people who are getting stroke, who are getting heart
attacks, it's not worth it.
It's just not
worth it.
So you can as well forget the money. And you know, tobacco, when we are really talking about control of tobacco, we are not saying dump tobacco. We are saying let's have alternative crops for people who are growing tobacco.
Right.
Let's encourage alternative crops for people who are trading in the cigarettes and other tobacco products. Other crops and other livelihoods.
Okay, because of the time, Mr. Baguma, can you talk to us about this campaign, how the churches and civil society people can come in, but also talk to us about the legal regime. Do we have a strong legal regime? Why can't we stick to it?
I think as far as 2004, there was a policy for banning non-smoking in public places.
Yes.
It was put under the National Environment Management Authority to implement. There are even supposed to be a police for the environment police. I had the minister the other day saying she's going to return the money to the treasury.
She can't find
because the police force has refused to put people there.
An environmental police.
Oh my God. We need to do sensitization. These, at least these are in place. But there are also laws coming up. There is a bill that has taken I don't know how many years. Why don't we just pass this bill for God's sake? And so the legal regime exists.
This is that anti-tobacco bill.
Absolutely. Yeah. Tobacco control.
Tobacco control.
Yes. This, why don't we pass it? So we have some things to work with. We are not enforcing them. And we have some things that are coming up, which we should do yesterday on the legal regime. And as for civil society, you see, tobacco for me is the most preventable cause of death in the world. So there is needless death. No consumer product kills as many people as tobacco does.
Doesn't matter
what. That is the message everyone of us should be carrying. Absolutely. Why are these people dying needlessly? And civil society, somebody talked about religious institutions. We preach more loudly. But the media, for me, is one of the most important civil society elements. And this center is going to be launched on Tuesday, 1st November.
All right. Where is it launching?
The Kasangati Trading Center, where the center is located.
Yes.
It's just next to the Kasangati Health Unit.
Right.
That is where the center is located. This is for the Makerere College of Health Sciences. And there is a public lecture near here in the city, in Serena Hotel. And
right,
all the people are invited.
Right.
We come and talk about these things. But we are targeting members of parliament. Tomorrow we have a breakfast with them. So, you know, all this is going on. And this is just the beginning as far as I'm concerned.
Right. Well, Kasangati is not a secret place.
No, it is very much
well known right now. So on that day, maybe you can make a date, go and see what they have said.
And along the roadside, you can see the center.
All right. Thank you very much. This is our dear guest, Time Castle Show. Miss Dr. Prossy Mugyenyi, manager at the Center for Tobacco Control in Africa. Thank you for coming to Spectrum, sir.
Thank you. And I hope people will remember to come for the launch on 1st. Please, everybody is invited to come for the launch at 9 a.m. at Kasangati. And at 2 p.m. in the afternoon, we shall have a walk, a no tobacco walk, from Lago to Serena for the public lecture. The Speaker of Parliament is the chief worker. Then from 3 to 5, we shall have a public lecture. Everybody.
Where is that?
Good morning.
Serena Hotel.
Serena Hotel, Conference Center, everybody. everybody is invited.
Dr. Robert Machangu from the World Health Organization in Kampala, thank you for coming to Spectrum. Sir.
Thank you. Thank
Mr.
You.
Richard Baguma, Uganda Health Communication Alliance, thank you very much indeed.
You're most welcome. Yeah.
Thank you for tuning in. I've been your host, Edmond Kizito. Spectrum will be back tomorrow. Up next, though, is the news in English.
It's the event of the year. ShopRite, Uganda's favorite supermarket, is opening in Nadia at Metroplex Mall along the northern bypass.